Welcome to part four of what I did at the Toronto AI User Group. The exciting conclusion awaits. Make sure you tune in. So now what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to make a model. By the way, I talked about all these things. They're pretty cool. So I'm going to do a more complex example. And obviously, machine learning is wonderful and deep learning is awesome. So I'm going to apply this to a love of mine, which is I'm going to make a convolutional neural network to detect whether it's tacos or burritos, which is an important data science problem, right? Because there is some general world confusion, and we need to fix it. Okay, so I did this thing here, so I can stop that. So what I'm going to do is this the right one? No, I went to the wrong screen. This is the right one. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a three-step process with TensorFlow to build this model. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you it already ran. So let's go to the experiments here, and I'll give it a second to load. Here's the latest run of my SEER experiment because it sees Mexican food, which is really important. And what you'll see in a second as it loads up is you'll see the three-step pipeline that we do. And the pipeline is basically prepare the images, do the training, and then register the model. And there it is. So you're probably wondering, well, what preparation are you doing for images? Well, these things are fairly finicky. Like if someone puts an alpha channel in one of your pictures, boom, right? Because I planned for three, RGB, right? And sometimes in some models, they switch the channels or they put the channels first, right? And you're like, ah, right? And so you have to pre-process this stuff a little bit. And so what I've done is you can see in my prep, I'm basically using TensorFlow, I'm basically looping through all of the files and pushing out TF records. And you can see here in the data, when I do the prep, it's basically a bunch of TF record files. Anyone use TF records before, by the way? Let me explain what TF records are then. TF records is just basically a way to store tensor data in an intelligent way. Do you want to add anything? Because maybe you know more about TF records than I do. Oh, good. I'm always worried like that more people know more. I actually know a lot of more people know more than me, and so if you have something to add, please add it. So basically, it's taking all of these images, resizing them to the appropriate size, making sure they have the right channel ordering, and then stuffing them into this TF record. And the reason why is because it makes it easier to train, and I'll show you shortly how. Once this data preparation step stops, and by the way, in Azure Machine Learning, when you do this stuff, we actually store that all these steps were run, right? And this data source is the parameter. So I can change where it's sourcing the data from at any time, and it will load different images, right? And you can see here, you can look at all the details of everything that happened. Here's the snapshot of the code that ran. Here are the logs that it output. Like, this is literally what it did. So notice that now, because I'm running it in the cloud, you have visibility and traceability into what actually happened. Because usually you just run it on your machine, which is nice, but it doesn't play well with others, right? And now, as you're noticing, the data science practice is involving now bigger teams. How do you interact with them appropriately? What if Sally left because she's the best data scientist you have, and then Bill comes in? Bill usually starts from the first, like, as a data scientist, I'd be like, okay, let me try logistic regression, decision trees. If it doesn't work, then let's go with something else. But if Sally already did that, and you can have a record of the experiments that happened, Bill can start at the right spot, okay? And that's what this is all about. When you're doing model training, for example, in this case, when it loads the detail, there's a way, and let me get to the model, because I didn't show you the actual training algorithm. So this is the prep step. By the way, if you're wondering, like, I want access to this, if you go to github.com, and then go to Cloud Scale ML. It's under this thing called SEER. And so everything is in here. You can totally do all of this stuff. If you want, I can run it on my machine right now. I can make it run on my machine. Here, let me do that so that you can see. LS. So run. Oh, sorry, conda activate tf run. Oh, that's not the one I want. Which one is it? Pipeline.command. It's going to delete all those folders, and then we're going to heat our hands by the. But here's the thing. I can run this all in probably under 5 minutes. Right? There it's building the TF records, right? Taking burritos and tacos and making the TF records. And this is going to take a while. Well, not too long. It's probably like 600 images. It's not that much. And I'll let it do that. So you can see that I am running it locally. Right now, you're not going to hear the GPU. But you will. And it's, oh, here we go. We're getting into it. Yeah. Oh, did you see this beauty? Look at this. Look at this beautifulness. That's cool, right? So, you can run it locally. But who's going to know I ran this locally? How am I going to share this work with other people on my team? Right. So what I'm saying is, as I said before, since all of this stuff, basically, like when it comes to Azure, you can use whatever you want. You could do the logging directly from here on your local machine and log to Azure Machine Learning so that you can have stuff that looks like this. Well, I'll give it a second to load up. But basically, if you log, you don't have to run it. I don't care where you run it. Use just the logging mechanism of the experiments, and you can log all of the metrics there. So for example, here is this one that I actually ran this one in the cloud, but let's just say you ran it locally and you logged out. In this case, I don't have it logging because it's running in an offline mode. But basically now you can track anything. For example, accuracy, loss. This is what I'm actually logging. And you can log it out as a chart or as a table. And I don't know why things are taking so long to load up. But basically you have a chart of the accuracy of this model and the loss function of it. So just do the logging here. Or maybe save the models there. I don't care what you do. Like, as long as I'm solving your problem, I'm happy. So if you have fantastically good machines, yeah, the way that you log these things, hold on, looks like there's no data in there yet, because I actually reran it, unfortunately, when I did the other one. So let me show you how this actually works for training. So, and you're probably wondering how the logs happen, and you can take this file. So basically, in this case, when I train, and this is why I really like TF records, is because now you can do something like this. This is the training data set, right? And what you can do is you can create this TF record data set with this train array. And basically, it's an array of the name of the files of the TF records. And now you can do some crazy stuff like, here's the parse record to pull out the vectors and the matrices. Here's the number of parallel calls we do. And it creates this pipeline of data that you can use when you're training. This is actually really cool. And usually I skip over this bit because the people I sometimes talk to don't understand this bit, but you do. This is why I'm starting to like the front part of TensorFlow. You can see here that I am model stealing, otherwise known as transfer learning. Right, I'm taking MobileNet and I'm just putting it into a sequential model with an output and a softmax. Right, which is kind of cool. And then you can see here that I'm optimizing this stuff. Now here is the bit that's interesting that gets to your point. How do I log this stuff, right? Notice that I have a couple of callback things. One is called the model checkpoint so that it just outputs models whenever it has one. But here's one that I created called an AML callback, right? And notice that it's called log AML. And notice that on the callbacks, when I do the fit, I'm passing log AML in. What does this do? I'm glad you asked. It turns out, and this is code that I've never shown, so I'm so happy that I get to show it to people because nobody looks at this. Basically, an AML callback is an implementation of a callback function in Keras that says anytime something is run, log it to the AML run. So if I put that callback into my Keras, fit, it's basically going to shoot metrics up to Azure Machine Learning, like TensorBoard. Yeah, you can make it so that you can create a new run and run it locally. Yeah, that's a good question. And so you can shoot that up. And if it doesn't work, let me know, because they told me it does.
So
run it on your local machine, but log up, right? TensorBoard is awesome too. And if you're doing TensorBoard, you can actually save those into the output folder of your run on the actual cloud-based one, and then you can call TensorBoard on the run in the cloud, or you can just run these, do these metrics, right? Now the thing is, again, when I say I'm serious, this is a buffet. You take whatever you want. If you're just gonna have the salad because that's what you want, great. If you already have powerful machines that do the thing, I'm a fan. But you can use other aspects of this stuff that may be helpful. And if it's not helpful, then I want to know why. Great, tell me why. And I mean that honestly. So great question. This is, again, you can just take this. Notice that the AML callbacks are using just they're just inheriting from the callback Keras function. And these are just the things that I override. Like when the batch ends, I'm gonna log all the metrics. All right. And notice. So I'm using whatever the TensorFlow data set does with a TF record set, whatever it does, it does. I'm not doing anything more than that. So I don't know how it does it. All I know is that when I create a TensorFlow data set, I'm using TF records. What it does with memory, well, I guess I do know a little bit. You can notice that when you're looking at TF records, it's pretty smart about how many it's pulling out. And so it loads it up from memory, and then I have this map function which parses the TF record into a batch output, right? And I'm doing 5 parallel calls, and so it basically has a memory pipeline of things that it's queuing up for it to do. And then it shuffles it. If the buffer size is 10,000, that means it needs to load up 10,000 records to do that shuffle, and then I create the batch size, and then I buffer prefetch by a buffer size of 5. So depending on how you order these, it will do the thing. And if you look at the TensorFlow documentation, it'll tell you about this. I'm not doing it. I'm just letting the framework. Because now notice you're getting into memory management and stuff, and so that's how it does it. Okay, so this is how I do the thing. And then the last thing that I do, and this may be a part of your workflow as well, is I am basically doing where's the model register? The last thing I'm doing is I'm basically finding the best model that it output, and I'm just saving it to Azure Machine Learning. If you only want to do this bit, great. Now you can version your models. And now what you're probably thinking, well, is a model a single file or is it a bunch of files? The answer is yes. Do whatever you want. For example, PyTorch YOLO happens to be, in its implementation that I've seen, it's like 4 or 5 files. So you put that all in there, right? And so the question is, well, how do you use this when you're actually going to run it? In Azure Machine Learning, we have the endpoints that you can create, and all you need for this is a Python file that has an init and a process and a run. And basically, the raw data comes in. You load up the model in the init so that it can store it in any global model, and then you just run it. Now I could just run this locally, and you can see it will do it. But you can put this in as a service as well. Okay. I'm running out of time. So I made this work, and you can download the code and try it yourself. There's a data set as well. You folks know that convolutional neural networks, especially with MobileNet, will do pretty good at this in a pretty short order, right? So I showed you the pipeline. So let's do a little review, and then I want to answer any questions. I don't care. Like, I want the most hostile of questions because my purpose here isn't to sell you something. It's to solve problems. And insofar as our stuff doesn't solve problems, I'm happy to learn about this stuff, because then I can write it down and be like, you know, the people in the group, because as I tell them all the time, you need to fix this, this, and this. But if I say you need to fix this and so-and-so from TD, whatever, said at the tournament that they need it too, they're like, oh. Like whatever you say has 10 times the weight that I say. Right, David? So I want to know. So just a little review of what we did. We talked about foundations, linear models, and neural networks. We did convolutional neural networks. We looked at Azure Machine Learning. We looked at machine learning pipelines. And we did a little bit more. If you go to that link, it'll ask you to sign up for something. You don't have to. You can just get some links that will show you a little bit of the docs of Azure Machine Learning. And then this other thing called MLOps, right? MLOps, which is DevOps for machine learning. And if you have a second, I can tell you that we also and I forgot to add this. I don't know why I didn't add this. We can also, if you've ever used something like for continuous integration, continuous deployment, we have something called Azure DevOps that does this. And notice that in our particular case, we can have pipelines that take your code. Let me go back. I went too fast. No, I didn't go too fast. That's the wrong one. We have things that will, when you check this code in, will automatically run a new Azure Machine Learning pipeline. And then we have CD things, which is continuous delivery, that anytime a new model is checked in to Azure Machine Learning service, will kick off an integration build for you. Right? And the cool thing about these is you can actually add steps that check if your model actually works, or if your model is racist, or if your model has ethical issues, and you can check those before you put it out, right? There's another thing we have that's called, oh shoot, Murnush stuff. What's it called? We have an interpretability toolkit which you can run on your models, which will run and say, if it's a black box model, it will tell you, if you change these kinds of inputs, this is what will happen. It will also tell you which features, right, affect your model the most. And some people think, well, if I take out gender or race or whatever, then my model is ethical. But it turns out that there can be combinations of features that can produce that same effect. And so you're able to do that, and so you'll be able to see that. For example, and I did a video on this, and I can get a link to you all if you want, where Manu shows this, and she showed, like, if you change gender, does it change pay scale? Right? And it's interesting. Or actually, it was job recidivism, where they would leave or come back for a job. So we have some stuff that will automatically do that for you as well in the cloud. But again, like I said, this is a buffet. It's not a 7-course meal where you have to sit and you feel awkward when you're like, oh, I just got a call. No, I didn't hear it. Well, I did. Bye. Right? It's not like that. It's whatever you want to use that's helpful to you. We want to be able to help you with that.